Jay, Arturo.
Good man, how are you? I at the office or home?
Okay. Okay. Hey, quick question. Quick question. Can excuse me. Can would you guys excuse me, how would you deal with a credit that exceeds closing cost on a transaction? I yeah. No. No, I understand that. I understand that the if it the credit we're talking about is it's well, what's the maximum credit on a typical loan? 3%? No inclusive cost. Okay. Yeah, but I understand. I understand. Okay. There's no and there's no way that the credit union will make an exception to that. Is that right? But let's go bigger than that. Say the credit is for 30 and closing cost is 20. You I know you is this would this have to go to management and see? Okay. Okay. Right, I get that. No, it's the credit is coming in is from the seller, right? Yeah. Yeah.
morning. Can you guys hear me? Can you hear me? Hello. Can you hear me?
Hello.
Welcome to Zoom. Enter your meeting ID followed by pound. Enter your participant ID followed by pound. Otherwise, you are in the meeting now. There are 19 participants in the meeting.
Is this a little better?
Lots better.
Thank you. Sorry for the technical difficulties there. We'll be getting promptly at 10 a.m. Eastern Time. My name is Peter Santiago. I'll be one of the people interviewed in addition to Jennifer Young, and as well as Bowman Key with his speech. So if you need anything on our side, please let us know.
Morning. Hey, PJ, can you just try and say something so we can make sure that your microphone's working?
Testing.
PJ?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, okay. PJ, do you have video?
Let me check.
That's great, PJ. Use that because we're going to want to be able to see you when he interviews you, okay?
Oh, of course. Yeah, I was more concerned about the mic. That's all.
Okay, yeah, it sounds good. Thank you. You can go back on mute.
Welcome. Back on mute.
You need to call now.
It's fine. This specifically isn't every day, but something similar.
You just got on. Can you mute yourself? Great. Brandon, can you just say something so we ensure your audio is good?
Yes. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning, Brandon. And then Jennifer, if you're on, can you just do the same just to make sure PJ's all set to go? Just want to make sure everyone can hear you guys great. Morning, everyone. We're going to get started in a couple of minutes here. And we're just waiting for everyone to get on. We'll give you a couple of minutes and we'll get rolling. Excited to have everybody together. All right, Jennifer, are you on? Get Jennifer on, and then we'll get going here. All right, so we're gonna get rolling here. So thank you all for joining us. It's exciting to have everybody from the Virginia, West Virginia region on. I know we also have a couple of guests. This is part of a series that we're doing here at Keller Williams to try to bring all of our connection, our culture, our learning, training into a virtual world as we deal with the new normal. So we've got a great group together today to share with you, Brandon Green, Jennifer Young, and PJ Santiago. So what I'm gonna do is just walk you through really quickly a couple of slides on mindset and what we've been working on as our regional agent playbook. And then I'm gonna turn it over to Brandon. And Brandon is a great business partner of mine who has been really leading the way in KW and the thought process and mindset across not just KW, but many different industries around this around the situation we're in. And he's gonna interview two of our top associates who are doing some amazing things and give you some practical tips on how we can continue to do business and succeed during these times. just to walk through this with you, this is our agenda. We're just going to go through the purpose of the call, and then we're going to get into the conversations, and then hopefully have a little bit of time maybe for some summary reflections and questions at the end. As you all know, these are different times. Like, we're waking up in a new normal. We're dealing with a new world. And I think one of the biggest challenges we have in all this is that uncertainty breeds fear, and fear is our enemy. You know, the world changed, and we've got to be up to get into action to move forward in that. And I think that means we got to wake up, we got to pay attention, and we got to mind our mindset. We have a tendency when things change to get a little paralyzed by that change, and it's really important for us to get into action. A couple of quotes that I wanted to share with you that I think are very important and salient at this time. One from Nelson Mandela. He says, "I learned that courage was not the absence of fear, but the triumph over it. The brave man is not he who does not feel afraid, but he who conquers that fear." I think that's really important in today's day and age, what we're dealing with, that there is some sense of anxiety in everybody. And it doesn't mean that that shouldn't be there. It just means we have to conquer that by getting into action. And Rosa Parks added a tremendous amount of perspective on that when she said, "I've learned over the years that when one's mind is made up, this diminishes fear. Knowing what must be done does away with fear." And so when we know what we have to do, we can get into action and we can move past fear and get going. And so today is really about what must be done. What must we do as real estate agents in this time to move forward? And we talked about five things to keep in mind, that we got to manage fear, that we got to stay grounded in the facts, level-headed and practical around health and safety issues. And we also have to understand that we're dealing with a lot of different things. And so we have to manage that and stay focused on what is really real, what the facts are, what's practical, and how we move forward. We got to check our mindset. We don't get to choose what happens to us. We don't get to choose the circumstances, but we do get to choose how we respond to those circumstances. And so we get to choose to stay positive. We get to choose to see the opportunities. And we have to remember that we got to consider both the short term, like what's happening right now, and where are we going to be 30, 60, 90 days from now, 6 months from now? How do we think about this in both the short term and the long term? You guys are really important in your communities, to the people that you lead, some of you in your teams, in your market centers, and in the communities that you serve. And people need us now more than ever. And we've got a fiduciary responsibility to move forward. If we're not focused on health and safety, which we need to be if we're sick or if we're caring for someone who's sick, we're not that, we've got a fiduciary responsibility to move forward. Life and business need to go on so we can ensure that we can care for and support the people who need us in our lives. And we have to do that in a different context and in different ways. We're all here on a Zoom doing it today. But that forward momentum is really important. Communication becomes really important with each other because things are changing rapidly. And we got to make sure that we're over communicating. And so that's the reason we've got the whole region on one Zoom, so we can communicate, stay connected, and move forward. And then last, we live in a connected world. We are all part of each other, and what we do affects one another. And that's one of our strengths here at Keller Williams, is the culture and the connectivity. And we need to retain that connectivity. Even though we're not physically together, we need to figure out how to stay connected in different ways. Fundamentally, we are stronger together. And so we got to figure out how we stay together during these times. So as a playbook for thinking about this, we sort of got into action. We said there's three important things that are really important. And over the next three Fridays, we're going to be doing this on Friday at 10 a.m. And so today we're focused on how you find revenue and operate in the existing world you're in. Next Friday, we'll talk about how you harness the database and technology to start building business for when we come out of this situation. And then the next Friday, we're going to talk about cutting expenses. So we have a playbook in the Virginia region that says, hey, number one, we got to figure out how to conduct business remotely and to grab market share with innovative business practices. So that's what today's conversation is about. The next one will be about planting seeds. We've got this 5 and 20. So what can people do every day? They could do 20 sphere of influence contacts, 20 social media touches, 20 contacts added and updated in command, and 20 consumer app downloads. If we do that, we're going to be building the pipeline and planting the seeds. These may be dark times now, but we want to plant seeds now so that we can harvest them in the future. And then finally, we need to survive to thrive. So we're going to focus on how we can reduce expenses. So that's the three sort of structures to this. And today we're going to focus on the first one. And I couldn't think of better folks to be with us here today to do that. So I'm going to turn it over to Brandon Green. Brandon Green was one of the co-founders with me of Keller Williams Capital Properties. He is an internationally known speaker, facilitator, and voice for entrepreneurs and for people in the real estate industry. So I'm going to turn it over to Brandon to lead us through our conversation today. So good morning, Brandon.
Thank you. Thank you, Bo. And good morning, everyone. I am really happy to see everybody, even if it's virtual. So wait. So man, what a week, of course. And I was thinking, how do I prepare for the meeting this morning? And one of the things that really caught my attention was reflecting this morning is just how amazing it has been to see our associates and our leadership teams pivot rapidly and make some innovative changes and advance almost immediately. And today we're going to talk about specifically what a couple of associates are doing, though I've also been having some conversations with leaders in other industries. And I can tell you many people right now are not pivoting anywhere near as close as we are outside of real estate and even within real estate and other brokerages. So just sort of kudos to the leadership teams and everybody for how fast we have accepted the fact that we're in a new shifted reality and everything therefore must be adapted to and change. Like, we're kind of a scrappy bunch and it's really a lot of fun. It's fun to see like how fast that's happened. So I want to really welcome the PJ and Jennifer Young who have joined us this morning. And what I'd like to do is really get into some of the specifics that they are doing right now in their business. And I thought we could start with Jennifer this morning. And so Jennifer, give us a hello. Make sure we can hear you okay.
Hi, can you hear me?
We can. Yes. Awesome. Fantastic. Great. Thanks. Good morning.
Good morning.
So I think everybody knows you, Jennifer, though. But let's not assume. Let's do a brief intro. We'd love to just get a little bit of your bio background. And then I've got some interesting questions for you and I can't wait to ask. So I'll give it to you. So give us the context that you're operating in and
we'll
have some perspective.
Hi, everyone. I'm Jennifer Young. I'm in the Chantilly office. I've been selling real estate 19, almost 20 years full time. And I'm excited to talk with you because I went through the last shift. And you know, this shift's different for me personally because in the last shift, I was single, no kids, and had a $1,500 mortgage. And now I have about 25 employees, a monthly expense of $175,000 or so. And, you know, things are different, but I'm really excited to take the bull by the horn. Our team's pivoting. I'm excited to learn from all of you and different people in the industry. And I think what I'd like to share and what I'm trying to encourage my friends and team members and clients too is to let's stay positive. We know this virus could get way worse than it is now. Hopefully not, but it could. So I think mental health is so important here. I think I'm a pretty positive, happy person and try to always have positivity in my team. But you know, these are difficult times. So one thing I wanted to share personally that's helped me get through this week and maybe the next few months is I have blocked my schedule in parts of three, which is helping me. So the first 3 or 4 hours of the day, hardcore lead gen. My lead gen right now is I'm an ISA and I'm calling leads, trying to get appointments, trying to get yeses from clients. I'm touching base with people, genuinely seeing how they're doing. I've got a lot of clients with illnesses and elderly, and we want to help them first and foremost, and then seeing if we can, you know, get business as well. But then I'm taking a 3-hour break or so during the day, and I'm taking a hike with my kids and getting out of the house because I and them will go crazy if we stay in the house all day. And that's helped me tremendously. So I just wanted to share that. And then after the hike, we're back on and I'm working and they're doing their thing. So that's helped me. And that's how I'm doing my day.
That is awesome. I love it. So you said all kinds of interesting things there. So let me just kind of dive into a couple of them. One is this isn't your first shift.
Yep.
Actually, the second big one, right?
Yes.
And you said that there are some things that are different and there are some things that are maybe similar. I think we know that how we got into the shift is clearly very, very unique. Mm-hmm. So have you started to track some of the similarities already? And so the situation may be different, but these things are the same.
Yes. Definitely. I mean, we're tracking showings and we're down in showings. We're down in lead count. But actually we're not down as many leads as we thought. This week we got 132 new leads in. Last week was 135. The week before is 140. So lead count in is not too down, which is exciting so far, but we definitely have less showings. We have sellers, you know, not wanting to sell or cancel. And we can talk about maybe that script in a minute. And obviously what's changed now is virtual, and everyone's talking about virtual. I did my first virtual listing appointment last night with a $1 million seller in Maryland, and it was an hour long conversation. I got a tour of the house, did my presentation, reviewed everything, sent her the listing paperwork afterwards, and I think we'll get it. So we didn't have virtual, we had digital pictures, but you know, in 2008, 2009, we weren't doing so much virtually. So I'm excited about today's technology. And I think those that capture that, pivot and run in that direction are going to be leaders in our industry, because we're going to help a lot of people without making contact with them. And also, I see everyone talking about virtual, but what are we doing? So I'm encouraging my team members to do Facebook Lives. I'm going to do a Facebook Live open house this afternoon at a vacant house we just listed this morning, and just trying to get out in the community to say, we're really doing this and we're using technology to our advantage.
So I heard right at the beginning something that is really critical, and that is you changed your actual routine.
Mm-hmm.
Some things are the same. I mean, lead generation, though, you inserted this 3-hour break, and then I don't know that I, and what was the third section? You said there were three sections.
Oh, I just getting back to work and lead gen again, or like I try to do the meetings in the afternoon and try to do listing appointment consultations in the afternoon. So I'm trying to do my outbound calls and lead gen the first third, take a break and be with my kids and get out in nature the second third, and then back at it on the computer for the third third of the day. And it's just allowed me to stay really energized during those hardcore sessions, because these conversations are hard too. I mean, the conversations with sellers, emotional, scared, worried, you know, and we are too a little bit, but I just share with them my experience of the last shift. And one of the things I'm saying to every seller right now that I would encourage you all to say is, we experienced the last shift, even if you didn't personally, your office or leader sure did. And the clients that listed now or did that price adjustment now to get the offer, we're so thankful, because if this market does shift and gets worse that we expect, the people who did the 5% adjustment now are going to be so thankful in another year or two. I believe that to my core. And so when I convey that to a seller, I'm so passionate about it. And I'm just saying, look, I'm not saying this because I'm being a salesperson and want to push to list your house. I truly believe this is the best time to get the best price if you're going to sell over the next couple years, because buyers are out looking. And the other quick script I'm using too, which I feel passionate about, is that we came from such a strong seller's market that we luckily are able to absorb this decrease in showing activity. You know, if we had come from a fall or November market, I'd be freaking out a little bit, but we came from such a seller's market that I think we're going to be able to absorb this.
What I really like about what I've noticed you've been doing is we have been doing a lot of statistical market updates. Like, this is actually what's happening. For example, I mean, just yesterday we were on a meeting and we learned that 511 new listings went on the market in the DMV on Wednesday. Yeah. So I think I've noticed you really ground people in actually what's happening, and you mm-hmm. know yourself and your business. Like, I had 132 showings versus 135. So that's, I think, a helpful way to keep our head in check and say, well, there's a lot that we're projecting could happen.
Mm-hmm.
The reality is we don't really know.
Yep.
But what we do know is what has happened, and we mm-hmm. can maybe look in smaller increments of time and project out a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm also hearing, how much has your activity on a day-to-day basis, other than going virtual and having this 3-hour break, how much has it really actually changed though? I mean, has it remarkably changed, or is it just modified a little bit and it's mostly the same?
Modified. You're right. It's mostly the same. We were in a good position before this happened, really, this week, where we were having half of our people work virtually anyways. My second transaction coordinator is virtual. My awesome rock star listing manager, who's been with me over a decade, has always been virtual. I've 2 virtual assistants already. So I feel really lucky that we were already in place to do virtual. But I think that the admin that were at our office, we're all probably struggling a little bit, because we used to see each other and laugh or have those, you know, breaks or lunchtime moments that I think we're missing. And I actually did a bad thing as a leader that you guys can learn from. I realize I haven't connected with my admin much this week. I've been so panicked almost about connecting with my agents, you know, saving deals because deals are falling out, helping them, encouraging them, and trying to wrap my head around what's happening. I kind of forgot about my admin, and we were worried a little bit. So we're doing a Zoom call actually right after this, but love on your admin and not just your agents, because I did not do that. And I didn't realize they were so worried, and I'm over here busting it saying we're going to be okay, but I haven't communicated that to them well. And I think we're missing that, you know, human connection. So we need to do more Zoom with our admin.
So I've got a couple comments on that. If you have some specific questions for Jennifer, type them into the comments and we'll get to a couple of them. And PJ, get ready, you're coming up here shortly. So I heard in what you said there, Jennifer, something that I personally have experienced too this week, which is I feel like the last 7 days has been a bit in emergency triage mode. Mm-hmm. Right, like saving deals, getting out new addendums, making sure people aren't freaking out, figuring out that. And I think now as we go into the next week, and I'm hearing you say it by you saying, I need to touch in now with the rest of the staff, we're taking a breath.
Yes.
We're saying, this is a marathon, mm-hmm. of which we don't know how long it's going to be. And so while the extra frenzy perhaps was helpful in the early stages, the adrenaline needs to now dissipate and we've got to sort of adjust into a new long-term routine.
Absolutely.
Hire a lot of extra care people. So I like what you're saying about that. What are you going to say to your admin when you talk to them shortly?
I'm going to remind them that we've been here before, that our team grew during the last shift, that there is going to be less business to be had, but we need to take as much market share as we can, which might mean we have to work five times as hard. It might mean there are five more touches. We're actually sending out my database manager, splitting up our entire past client and sphere list today, and all admin are becoming ISAs today as well. And we're all in this together. So nobody says this isn't my job or nobody says I don't do this, because if we all want to have a good career still, we all need to be in the same boat. And so everyone's going to be calling our past clients and genuinely just to say hi and check in, because I have hundreds of booties at my house. My team's been picking them up from my front door and I'm going to offer that to clients or drop it off to elderly. So we're going to check in with everyone, but everybody in my team is going to start making calls today to drum up more business.
So let's get to a couple questions specifically that people have, and then PJ will come to you. So this is from Anthony Jones. What about home inspections? Virtual, how are you handling those?
Great. So we're still doing home inspections, but being super cautious. Like when we have them available, we're bringing masks, gloves, and booties to our clients. My agents are wearing those too. And we're just bluntly saying that we're social distancing to stay, 3 feet away, but we're also offering them virtual. And some people are taking us up on that. And we're definitely seeing an increase in virtual showings, which is working well. And we're still getting contracts. So home inspections and showings, we're in such a unique business because we're not doctors or nurses in some ways that can justify having to go out every day, but people still need to buy or sell homes. So I think we should encourage everyone to do it virtual, including home inspections. But if they want to be there, be there. I think make sure no symptoms, even though you can be asymptomatic, I know, but just have distance and be smart about it.
Great. Thank you. Katrina says she's got a virtual listing appointment on Monday. Any tips, thoughts on how to make sure that's successful?
However you're doing it, Zoom, Skype, FaceTime, just make sure you and the client have done that before, prepared, downloaded it. We did fumble yesterday because I didn't have something downloaded and we were a few minutes late to our call and it just didn't start off smooth like it should. So start early and prepare, obviously a quiet space. And then make sure you can talk about comps, like the back of your hand, just like you would in person. I would still do a net sheet in person. I am still shocked how many agents are not doing net sheets. So for everyone in person or virtual, do net sheets because our competition's not doing it. And I cannot believe, so everyone should do net sheets virtually too.
Yes.
And then I think the key is follow-up. Like we have a really aggressive follow-up plan and I'll share it with you real quick because we have to put that on steroids even. Like we'll do an appointment and then we'll send a handwritten thank you note and then we'll do an email within 24 hours summarizing the to-dos, sending a photography tip sheet and just summarizing what we talked about. We call to make sure they got that follow-up email, check in the next day, send updated comps. And then you need to get even more aggressive with your follow-up because what if it went to spam? What if the client's having a bad day because they're worried about their elderly parent or something? So I think more touches are really important in this current climate.
Yes. Thank you. I've got one from Ruth. How to handle seller clients who were just about to put their house on the market this month and they're now kind of freaking out. How do I get the, that's one question. She has a second question, but let's start with that one. Seller who's freaking out.
And this is kind of what I touched on before. So Ruth, you're the seller. Ruth, I hear you. I've had many clients that have felt the same way. And this is what you need to do. You still need to put your home on the market. I'm not saying this to be a pushy salesperson. I've been doing this almost 20 years and I did it through the last shift. And I promise the sellers that put their house on the market are going to be happy with the results, even if it means a little bit less than we thought it was going to be a month ago. Because if this gets worse, and I hope it doesn't, but if this gets worse and our economy doesn't, you know, recover quickly, and we're having the same conversation 2 months from now, or maybe 2 years from now, there's a good chance your price is even less. So while people are still able to look at homes, while rent interest rates are at a 50-year low, we have to get your house on the market. I just sold a townhouse in Reston with 10 offers. We just put a full price 989 house on the market and got full price 3 days later, a 425 house, and people are out there buying. So I'm not going to paint, you know, pretty picture. These are tough times, but I promise you, you're going to thank me later by selling now and not hoping the market's going to get better in 6 months, because it might not.
I love that. Thank you. Can we do a similar script for a buyer who's freaking out and is like, you know what? I don't think I want to buy anymore.
Yep. I hear you. So it's always feel, felt, found. I understand how you feel. I've had other clients that have felt the same way. And what we found is the clients who get out there are seeing less competition and they're able to capture the 50-year low interest rates. Let's take precautions and separate. And I have gloves and masks for you, et cetera. But you know, that house that used to have 10 offers, now it's only getting one or two offers. So many people are sitting on the couch. This is your time to get a good value and capture the 50-year low interest rates, because you said this is going to be your forever home. So let's get out there and do it. I think focusing on the facts about interest rates being low and how we're going to make them feel comfortable, and of course, offer virtual showings is important. I mean, you know, I say that, and we have had buyers cancel, and we have had sellers cancel, but without these scripts, I think our cancellation rate would be way higher. And I think people need to be reassured. And I just am so passionate about this, because when we had this tough conversation back in 07, when things were really changing, it was so uncomfortable. It was not pleasant, but those clients that listened to us were so thankful come 08, 09 and 10, you know, the market did crash and was lower. So I am passionate, and I really believe that this is the time they're going to get the best price, and they just need to be educated, and they need to hear that you're selling homes. So if you haven't sold a home in the last week, use what I just said, because we're kind of a big team, or use a success in your office and said, we sold this home, because homes are selling and we need to get that message out.
We do. I love that. You just convinced Matt he needs to buy a house, and you just convinced Troy he needs to list his house. So good job on doing that. So final comment, then we'll move it over to PJ. So, you know, words of wisdom into next week. Like, you know, we're certain to get a lot more craziness next week. That's kind of the norm. What are you telling your team? How are you keeping people's head focused around productivity as we close out this week and we move into the next?
Yep. So we're trying to do individual Zoom calls with each team member this week to keep them motivated and their eye on the prize. I'm telling them my personal experience about the last shift, how we're going to make this through, but it's going to take a lot of work. I know that everyone might not make it, and I hope everyone does, but the agents that call and take this seriously are going to thrive through this market. And I would just tell you that it's not fun, and it's going to be hard. And, you know, it was kind of easy to make money, right? So far this year. I mean, it was challenging with the multiple offers and it being a seller's market, but the business was there, and now we're shifting, and it's going to take you picking up the phone every single morning. And so when I see, you know, all these agents are doing Facebook posts, which is important, we need to do that. But then I'll see even within my own team, chat groups and jokes. And I'm like, guys, you got to get on the phones. This is not funny anymore. Seeing my admin or ISAs or agents joking with each other is nice for camaraderie, but this is 2 o'clock in the afternoon and you need to be talking to clients or you're going to be crying about no money in 2 months. So I'm just reminding everyone that what you do today is going to be your income 60 to 90 days from now. So if you want to still flourish and meet your financial goals, and everyone on my team, we have their yearly financial goals. We talk weekly or biweekly about that. If they're not taking action today, then they're not going to make money in 60 and 90 days. And I think that is motivating them and getting them to realize this is serious. And the last thing I'll leave with, and maybe we could do another webinar about this in a couple of weeks when things settle down, but I think that short sales and loan mods are going to come back given the times. We're already seeing clients struggling with their mortgage payment a little bit. And we're offering extended services, like I'm negotiating a lien from a lawyer someone has on their property so they can accomplish a regular sale, just part of our services. All you need to do is get a third party authorization signed. I'm talking to the lawyer and saying, look, I need you to take that $25,000 lien down to $5,000 or $10,000. I'll get you paid in 30 days, but I need to get my client's home sold as a regular sale. And we have to think outside the box and get creative. And we need to educate ourselves, I think, again, on how to help our clients do a loan mod, how to do a short sale, become familiar with foreclosures. I hope it doesn't happen again, but it might. And the agents that lead that and can talk intelligently about that process are going to be, I think, the experts in the field.
Brilliant. Thank you. Two things I want to highlight. I love your leadership around transparency, authenticity. You know, you're not sugarcoating it, but you're also not over dramatizing it either. You're mm-hmm. saying, hey, you know, let's be compassionate and move forward. And the other thing that I'm having an aha on here is a lot of things have changed and a lot of things have not.
Mm-hmm.
We could have had this conversation a month ago and everything you said would have been pertinent.
Yeah. Right? Thanks. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's same stuff.
Same stuff. Lead generate.
Yeah. Yep. Back to lead generation. That seems exactly. to be the solution to pretty much everything.
Everything, yeah. Thanks, Jennifer, Brandon. Thank
you. Really appreciate
good luck, everyone.
It. Thank mm-hmm. you, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Yep.
All right, PJ, let's move over to you, please, sir. PJ, give us a hello so we can know that we got your audio. PJ, 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 let me find him. You're on mute there, sir. Let's see if we can get you to unmute. There you go. Hey, can you say something? See if we can hear you. Hello, hello, testing.
Testing 1, 2, testing 1, 2.
Excellent. Move closer to your computer too, PJ, so that we've got really, really good audio on you. Good. So thank you for being here, PJ. For those that do not know you, can you give us your perspective on or give us a sense of your business, where you're operating, the size and scale of it? You're going to bring a different type of perspective than Jennifer does, so we're excited to hear about that. So tell us a little bit about you and your business.
Sure. My name is PJ Santiago. I was born in Washington, D.C., Northeast D.C., and I was actually a foreclosure prevention housing counselor back in 2009 and 2010. And I actually worked in loss mitigation and foreclosure prevention with Freddie Mac through government and industry relations and the borrower outreach team from 2010 until I became an agent in 2011.
So thank you for that. You know, I actually didn't know some of that. That's very interesting. I guess I didn't know you then. So thank you for that extra background. So tell me, sure. PJ, how are you processing what's happening in the last week or two? And specifically, what are you doing in your business to respond?
Well, there's a couple of things that I have in terms of perspective. Number one, I'm one of Filipino Chinese immigrants. My dad's from the Philippines. My mom came in from China. And my dad provides food, and my mom provides communist revolution. So if you think about it, in the grand scheme of things, coronavirus is kind of cake compared to those two. So when you have that in mind and I put that into perspective, I realize that
audio for a minute. So if you're with us and not talking, make sure you put yourself on mute so we can clarify PJ's audio just a little bit, if you could. And then PJ, where is your audio source coming from? Awesome, man. Let's see if we can get that cleaned.
Is this a little better?
That's a lot better. Yes. Thank you, sir.
Excellent. Yeah. But once again, my dad basically survived World War II. My mom survived the Communist Revolution. And those two things are much more dramatic, actually involve death on a regular basis than what we see with the coronavirus. And in general, that's why you have a little bit more of this calm, keep peace and carry on over in China and over in the Asian countries because of that. With me in general, I know that positive affirmations are really helpful. They help me get through the day, especially with what's going on around me. And also the idea that if I want positive change, if I want to see that sense of community within the area around me, I have to be that source. I have to be the person that creates that.
Thank you. I agree. That's really beautiful. So in terms of action, what have you done in the last week? I've noticed a couple things on Facebook. So share with us, what have you actually done to respond that has been productive and beneficial in your business?
Well, the first thing that I've done is all of my out-of-town clients that are military that have come in that say they are not comfortable, you know, making a move, they're not comfortable purchasing, I still keep their auto searches alive. And I politely ask them, if you want me to take a look at a property for you, I'd be more than happy to do a video house hunt with you to see the homes. I'd be glad to do it. And it's kind of funny because one of those clients who I did that video house hunt with fell in love with the house after me doing a tour of the property to the point where they are submitting an offer on that house today.
Oh, awesome. So are you saying you did a complete virtual video house hunt for a client and they're making an offer on that property?
Through Google Meetings and Google Hangouts, yes.
So they just to clarify, so they didn't go to the house at all. You just went with your phone and did the virtual, like completely virtual buy.
No, they did not, but there is a catch. Before you leave the house, you absolutely positively have to make sure that whatever doubts or questions they have regarding the home, any issues related to the furnace, any issues related to the actual neighborhood feel itself, you have to make sure that you answer those questions before you leave, because the last thing you want, number one, is to go back to the house to do an actual video tour, because the property might not be there anymore. And number two, you have to make sure that your clients have peace of mind and that sense of security, so that when they do move forward with a contract, they feel comfortable submitting.
So for those that maybe haven't done a complete virtual showing for their client yet, can you just walk us through technically, what are you using? Are you using Zoom, Google Hangouts? Are you just recording it as a video? How are you transmitting that to your client? Kind of walk us through some of the tech on that, if you could.
It's really interesting because when I work with my counterparts in the industry, you know, foreclosure prevention housing counselors, mortgage, loan officers, so on and so forth, Zoom tends to be the best option. But when it comes to working with consumers, the majority of the general population that's not within a certain business or certain industry like real estate is unfamiliar with Zoom, and they don't feel comfortable downloading it on their phones. So what I do is, because I'm big into time blocking, I time block their house hunt. And at the time when I do time block, there is a Google video code that they can tap, which connects directly into Hangouts, which a lot of my clients have on their phones because it's Google. And we're able to video in while we walk through the property with them asking any questions they may have.
Right. So you're doing a live video Google Hangout using your phone. They're on the other end and you're walking them through live. It's not a recorded video. It's actually a live interaction showing.
Plan B, if there is a situation where we have issues with signal, cell phone signal, for example, what I do is I do the actual tour. I make them aware of any problems that I personally could find or any things that could lead to potential issues. I also make them aware of some items that you typically don't find in certain homes. For example, yesterday I made them aware that the water heater was actually at the 15-year mark, and the overall life expectancy of both gas and electric water heaters is 8 to 12 years. So I basically said, you know, this is past the typical life expectancy. Just be aware of that. A home warranty may be helpful. Heads up. But I also went into the garage and I noticed that they had this exceptional amount of storage for a property in Springfield, Virginia on a townhouse.
Right.
Because townhouses in Springfield, Virginia typically don't have that kind of storage space. So I actually literally went inside the closet and then I showed everything that was going on like this. And then I basically made them aware, like, I basically said, look, this is unusual. You typically don't find this in Northern Virginia, and especially in this part. You do find it in Loudoun County. You do find it in parts of Ashburn. You do find it in parts of Chantilly, but not here. So this is something that's unique to this part of Springfield and the West Springfield High School District. So you typically want to make them aware of the pros and cons, and you want to show that level of objectivity with the property. And if you genuinely like a house, make them aware of it, but just make sure that you give them the caveat that that's your personal opinion, your personal perspective. If you do not like the property, same scenario, just make them aware it's your personal perspective, your opinion.
So I'm hearing a couple things. One is I'm hearing some just really good showing protocol for how to show a house. Second, though, is I am hearing another level of detail around zooming in on certain things like, appliances, storage space, et cetera. Things that you wouldn't necessarily stick your head all the way up into in every showing. And so you're going at that in a little more detailed level. I really like that. I mean, many of us have done that with relocation clients. So we're just saying, hey, we've got to maybe turn more of our showings into those virtual showings. Just a couple comments that are coming up here. And by the way, if you have questions for PJ, let's go ahead and start to post them. Some sight unseen addendums are good ideas. Are you using any additional disclosures or addendums, sight unseen sort of stuff for your clients?
Me, typically, no. But I do make them aware that, you know, you do have your traditional ways, the back of the contract, the Virginia Property Owners Association Act, home inspection, radon testing, financing and appraisal. Okay. So once again, they are aware that there are ways to back out of the contract. And if there are any issues that they discover when they eventually physically walk through the home, which does happen in most of the cases that I'm in, they'll find it. But with regards to an actual addendum like that, I do not include it in any of the buyer agreement paperwork I send out before I go hunting. And two quick things before we move on. Number one, getting them to if they seem a little uneasy about signing the buyer agreement, and they know that you're going to be one of the few agents that actually allows for the video house hunt, they will sign that agreement if you make them aware that it's easy to break if you get in contact with the managing broker or if you're not satisfied with the services. And number two, there is an element that you can include with your video house hunts or your video opens that most people do not even think about, almost to the point where if you actually visit a property with an agent, 99% of the time you forget about it and you don't see it. And that, oddly enough, is with the selfie stick. If you have to connect your phone to a selfie stick, you can actually get into certain corners of the house, certain parts of the property that you typically can't do if you were there physically with an, you know, old school real estate agent or with an individual who doesn't have that kind of reach or height. The funny thing about that is you have that advantage that is exclusive with virtual hunts to the point where I've actually had clients prefer virtual hunts over physical hunts.
You know, that's so interesting. So, yeah, get that selfie stick up here in the attic and try to, I love that. That's brilliant. Yeah. PJ, let me ask you two questions. One, are you saying to your buyers who are saying, you know what, I'm really a little freaked out about all this. I don't think I want to buy. What do you think?
Well, I make them aware that if you do not feel comfortable making a move, I respect that and I understand. But I'm also aware that as of right here, right now, interest rates are literally at a record low. I have been in the industry for 19 years. I studied finance. I've been looking at the history of the American economy as a whole, and I have never seen this in anything that I've looked at in my life. I don't know what's going to happen in the future, but I do know that right here, right now, that is the reality, that is the truth. And if you want to take advantage of that, I strongly encourage you to make that move because I have no idea what's going to happen in the future. Just like no one had any idea that all these restaurants will be closed, all these stores will be closed, and the New York Stock Exchange will be on circuit breakers right now. So that's typically what I tell them on the buyer side.
What I'm hearing is just a real authentic conversation with someone and acknowledging that this is an opportunity for some people. And it depends a lot on the buyer's circumstance, whether that's an opportunity for them. Thank you for that. Open houses, virtual open houses. Are you doing that?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
How does that work technically?
Well, I did my very first virtual element of the open house 5 years ago. Which is oddly enough was the same time when I did my very first listing presentation via Google Hangouts as well, 5 years ago before Zoom became big. Which by the way, when you do work with the listing side, you definitely want to send out the website that you use with all the marketing material. I strongly encourage you to make a YouTube video as well of the property so you can share the YouTube link. On top of that, send all the additional addendums and the agreement paperwork as well. From there, I would also consider sending out a progress report that you did in the past for a previous seller on a property that didn't sell within 2 weeks, just so they have that expectation that the current market we're in can in fact turn into a very unpredictable arena when it comes to the sale of properties, to the point where they know in their back of their mind that this is a possibility. We're not going to blame the agent. We're going to blame the economy as a whole. The next thing is when it does come to the actual virtual open house, once again, I use it as a compliment to the actual open house that I ran. Because quite frankly, I was bored because there's cases where no one showed up because little things like Hurricane Sandy.
Yeah. So this isn't our first like, go at I that. Still, yeah, right.
Yeah, just a little, you know, little things. And the thing is, but I went through the open house and there was no one around. I knew that that would be a possibility, you know, the next time around. And what I ended up doing was when I did the open house, you know, when I did the open house info, I basically said, please contact the real estate agent if you would like to have a virtual open house with the property. And that's when people from actually overseas would come and get in contact with me. I would actually walk them through the home, same scenario as a buyer consult, ask and answer questions, or answer questions that they're asking me, ask questions in return just to make sure I gain an understanding of what they're looking for. And at the end of the day, that element, which was a compliment to the open house, was something that I did based out of sheer boredom being in an open house.
So, sheer boredom creates some innovation, huh?
Yeah, basically. I mean, to me, I think it was a sloppy move on my part, and I take responsibility for not probably doing a good enough job when it comes to marketing outside of the MLS, when it comes to door knocking. I take responsibility for that. But at the same time, I have to show my value, and I have to show that you hired the right person to represent you and your best interest on the sale of your home. And that's where I kind of come into play. So when they find out that I have international investors all cash at these open houses going through the property, you know, they have that confidence back on my back to the point where they believe in me and trust in me to be their agent.
So I have one more question though. If you're not following the chat, for those of you who have joined us, take a look at that. There's been some really great resources posted in the chat around the COVID-19 addendum that has come out from VAR and NBAR. some other tips and thoughts too. So some added value happening on the side with the chat feature there. So PJ, yeah. Let me ask you about your personal routine. What, if anything, has changed in your personal routine? You said you're a time blocker, you do that. Can you walk us through your day right now? What's that looking like?
Sure. Before I go though, I just want to say one quick thing about virtual open houses. Okay. Now that it's the primary and not the complementary, I strongly encourage you to go back into the Zoom route and to actually create a queue to a point where when multiple people sign on to the virtual open house, you can put them on hold, give one person their undivided individualized attention. And then when they hang up, go to the next person, go to the next person, then go to the next person to the point where you're basically handling them in a systematized approach, excuse me. When it comes to my daily life, the thing that I'm doing differently is I'm actually shopping.
You're shopping. What do you mean?
Yeah, I don't want to brag. It's just I'm really good at finding supplies and finding deals. It's just kind of one of those things that, I mean, don't get me wrong, I'm terrible at a lot of things. It's just I'm good at that.
Okay.
And I know that there are a lot of people out there that need, you know, antibacterial gel, a lot of people that need Clorox wipes, a lot of people that need toilet paper, so on and so forth, to the point where now I'm doing all these activities geared towards one event with a HUD-approved housing counseling agency that's VHDA certified to help with foreclosure prevention, where I'm giving away free toilet paper, I'm giving away free post-surgery wipes, I'm giving away free alcohol wipes. Okay. I'm putting in there a brochure that talks about the type of loss mitigation solutions that are available, including foreclosure prevention initiatives, loss mitigation, forbearance, interest rate reduction, so on and so forth, as well as a piece of paper that says that if you do not want to keep your home, or if you do not want to go with the modification route and you prefer cash, contact PJ Santiago with KW Capital Properties. I'd be honored to help you on the next stage of your life. So I'm spending more of my time towards debt events than I am towards the usual lead gen, which, by the way that I usually approach that is through providing RPR and CMAs for each property. My past buyers that I've worked with, making them aware that within that proceed sheet, this is the amount of money you could make, and asking them politely, with this amount of money in play, would you feel comfortable and confident moving on to the next house that you're looking for, whether it's an upgrade or a downsize? So that's typically great. The way that I approach it when it comes to lead generation on a daily basis. I will admit that I'm not sleeping as well as I should because I'm thinking about how to help people, so to speak. Yeah. But in general, I'm going to do what I can. So.
I think all of us have had an interrupted sleep week, that's for sure. One question that I want to get to, I do not think we've covered, I want to hit it. It's from Dave. How do people know to go to your virtual open house? How are you advertising that open house?
So here's the challenge with this. It's highly ill-advised to actually use the open house button on Bright MLS, because all that does is encourage people to go through the property and create a crowd to the point where you are not smashing the curve anymore. Okay. You're not flattening the curve anymore.
So what are you doing?
So do not use that. I have not done an open house since all the lockdowns have taken place yet. I do have one scheduled this Sunday, and typically you have to go through your database. So definitely upgrading and working your database, it's gonna be a priority. Also, you're getting connected with social media, as well as updating the remarks, actually, both the agent remarks and the consumer remarks on Bright MLS, updating that and setting it up to the point where it shows up as a brand new listing on everyone's auto search with that first remark showing virtual open house. You know, and by the way, when you do a virtual open house, this is something that I learned. You can do it at unusual hours because everyone that I know that's in the government contracting world is stuck at home.
Right.
They have nowhere to go. They're looking for a distraction. So that's Tuesday, right. Wednesday, Thursday, Friday for an open house is perfectly fine. You have nothing to worry about, especially since you want to secure the property and make sure no one else enters the home while you're there. So to answer your question, updating remarks, updating agent remarks, attacking the database and social media are going to be the best ways to approach advertising an open house, knowing that the other one could be a liability, could be a health hazard, and could be detrimental to leading to the growth of the coronavirus in this area.
Michael really liked that comment. He said, really great point there. I was stuck in my head about the old thinking on doing it on the weekend, but you're right. Everybody's home. Let's do one any time of the day. PJ, thank you. What I really appreciate about you is your ability to both take what you've already been doing technically and upping your game almost immediately. So if you're not following PJ on Facebook, or I guess I don't follow you on Instagram. Are you on Instagram too? Yeah. or just Facebook?
Yeah, I actually got DC and Nova Real Estate as my Instagram handle.
Okay. Say that again. What's the handle?
Yeah. Oh, DC and Nova Real Estate. There's DC underscores under each word.
Okay. Yeah. DC and Nova Real Estate.
And Nova Real Estate. And by the way, Keller Williams has done a lot for me in my career. I worked at Freddie Mac in foreclosure prevention and loss mitigation, but I also got laid off by Freddie Mac, even though I was working 60 hours a week. And KW basically created a family for me. They were my heart. And if any of these 344 participants have any questions about running a virtual buyer consultation that I've been doing for actually 6 years, the virtual listing appointment I've been doing for 6 years, the virtual open that I've been doing for four, and the virtual house hunt that I've been doing for four, don't hesitate to message me. We're a family. We're KW. I'm happy to help you out.
And the best way to reach you is how?
Facebook Messenger is the best way to go. I get, my phone blows up with messages from everybody all the time. Just be patient, but I promise I'll get back to you just like everyone else who's messaged me within the last 24 hours.
Thank you, PJ. I love your heart. I love the fact that you're just going and getting it and making an opportunity out of this. So thank you for your contribution today.
And you're absolutely correct. That is an opportunity. It's there. And I know that there are going to be people who will not only succeed and make a lot of money in this, but will also help out the greater good of the community in response to your success. It's going to happen. It's an inevitability. So
thank you. Happy to do it. So I'm going to turn it over to Bo here in a minute, though. As you have ahas from what you've heard today, type them in the comments so that other people can.
Brandon, can I say one more thing? Sorry.
Yes, of course. Yes,
okay, one more script because PJ just reminded me of this. And PJ, I'd love to talk to you later. I didn't know you had so much experience in foreclosure prevention. I think that's awesome. You said something about move up. Yeah, cool. You said something about move up buyers. And I think this is an important script for today. If we do have, let's say, a 10% decrease in value, but you're selling your $500,000 home to buy that $700,000 home, you're going to take the $50,000 haircut on your departure home, but you're getting $70,000 off on that move-up home. So you're saving $20,000. We should be telling everyone that, thinking about doing a move-up. And I'll even tell people, in a down market like this, you don't do a downsize. I mean, you can if you need to, but where you capture the value is moving up. So yeah, we're selling your $500,000 house for $450,000, but we're getting you that $700,000 house for $630,000. So look at what you're making. And it always makes sense to do a move up in a down market. I just wanted to share that script.
Thank you.
Yep. You're absolutely correct. And it's the way it's going out. It's when you leave it. That's what I learned in the finance world. It's the going out of it where you make the most money. Actually. Yeah. So that's definitely a great script. I love that. Thank you.
That's good. That's brilliant. And Jen, we didn't get a chance to ask how, if people want to reach you, what's the best way to do that?
I don't know, Facebook Messenger maybe, or jennifer@jyhteam.com. Okay. And I think we're definitely going to talk to leadership and we'll do some more classes on loan mods, foreclosure prevention, short sales. And, I think that's probably coming in the weeks and we all could use some brush up on that.
Thank you. Well, so lots of stuff here, I think was absolutely brilliant from the both of you. So just to round of applause. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you to the both of you for that. I heard a lot of things. I mean, I've got literally four pages of notes here. A couple things that stand out and then I'll move it back to Bo. You know, a lot of things have changed, but a lot of things have not too. If you really distill down what PJ and Jennifer have been saying, these are some really solid best practices on any day of the week. So it seems to me that this is an opportunity for us to just clean up our business a bit. And do what we know we need to do anyway. So I thought that just hit me in a different way today. And the second is, what you see from these two is they're moving quickly and positioning themselves to be number one in all the areas that they're working in. And Gary Keller said this earlier today, and it stuck with me all week this week, which now's the opportunity to position yourself for number one. And that's an exciting thought. And you do that through a lot of care and compassion and concern. You saw that coming through these two entrepreneurs. Clearly, these are very, very successful folks, and they lead with heart. And there's never been a better time for that. So thank you for that. All right, Bowman Keady, I'm turning it back over to you.
Great, Brandon. Thank you so much. I really appreciate all of you and really pouring into us. Thank you, Brandon. Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you, PJ. My phone is blowing up with all people's comments about how much they value you guys taking the time to share with all of us what's going on. I wanted to just take a couple of minutes to let you know that this is our upcoming schedule of our Playbook Action Plan. Next Friday at 10 a.m. we'll be walking through some of the things that you heard PJ and Jennifer allude to, which is how do we actually start cultivating our database and cultivating the people that we're in relationship during this time, and deep using the opportunity to deepen our relationships and to make sure that that pipeline is robust as we come out of this. And then finally, on Friday, April 3rd, we'll be talking about how you cut expenses and make sure that you're doing that in a thoughtful and effective way to manage your business through this time. I just want to quickly let you know that every day at 10 o'clock, the regional tech director, David Donaldson, is doing a tech training that digs into the different elements of our 5, 20, and 2020. So you can dig into your SOI, your database, your command app downloads, your social media integration, and how you're running campaigns. Oh, Jennifer, that's great. Ensuring that folks are ready to go to execute that plan. I just wanted to leave you with a couple of thoughts. Maya Angelou said, I've learned that people will forget what you said, people forget what you did, people will never forget how you made them feel. This is a time that people need you now more than ever. You guys are leaders in your community, your clients, your team members, the people in your neighborhoods are depending on you, and you have a tremendous opportunity and a responsibility in how we deal with people during this time. It's a real humanistic time. It's a time to be in touch with everyone as you move through that. And then finally, I just wanted to leave you with one of my favorite quotes for the time being from Bruce Lee: to hell with circumstances, we create opportunities. And so it's an honor to be with all you guys as you move beyond the circumstances to create opportunities and to be there to support each other. Together, we're stronger. We're stronger together. If you guys want to be in touch with what's happening on, you can follow Brandon at Brandon Green. You can follow me on Instagram at Bo Minkiti. You can stay up to date with what's going on and what's happening, because truly together we can be stronger, and we're stronger together. So be safe, be strong, and stay together. It's an honor to be in business with all of you guys. Thank you guys so much for being with us today, and have a wonderful day.
Thank you all.
Take care.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.